The sky is a deep and cloudless blue. The sun's shining. It's lunchtime and I need some air, so I walk out of the office, leaving the document I'm writing mid-sentence. I walk down the busy street, noisy with traffic, to the grocer to buy some potatoes for dinner. The grocer hands me my bag and my change, and I fumble, drop the coins, almost hitting my head on the counter on the way up. He laughs sympathetically at my clumsiness, says, "You okay?" I say, "I think my husband has lung cancer." Just like that. And he starts to say something, and I hold up my hand, and I turn around and get out of there as fast as I can. From the grocer, I go back to work. Tell my boss I have to go. A sudden headache I can't shake. "I'm sorry," I tell him. "I just feel terrible." He lets me go. Tells me I look pale. And instinct kicks in, and I want my mother to make this better.
When you were a kid, you were really bad at keeping secrets, and you always had to tell people, and there was this rushing up and telling people this very secret thing, and then you'd say, "Oh, and it's a secret."
I catch the bus to see her. I'm Sophie Townsend, and this is Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 2, The Secret. It's a long bus ride, and as we snake past the old wool store and the fish markets and into the suburbs, I can close my eyes and half fall asleep. I'm so familiar with the rhythm of the streets, the corners and hills, the stops and starts. It's like going back in time, almost, which is all I want to do right now.
Oh, I saw how anxious you were, incredibly anxious and fearful.
She makes me a cup of tea and we talk. We've been waiting on Russell's test results this week. He'd had a biopsy the day after his scan, but had to have another one 3 days later. Something hadn't worked and the results were inconclusive. Russell has been quiet in this week of waiting. "No point thinking about it," he'd said. Although I can see him thinking about it. He doesn't want to predict, he says. Doesn't want to speculate. Doesn't want to talk. And so I talked to my mother.
"I just did not want this to happen to you. I just did not want this. It was absolutely hideous to watch this and really feel that fear for you and feel the fear that you were having and how were you going to cope with this. It was so big, and every time I talked to you, I'd go and look up whatever you'd said and look at prognosis and, you know, survival rates and God knows what. Oh, I just wanted it to be different. I just thought this shouldn't be happening."
Russell and I are sitting in a small consulting room in the hospital with a chest specialist. He clears his throat an awful lot, and I can tell this is getting to Russell. It's getting to me too, but I'm trying not to show it. I'm trying to be positive about the chest specialist, about his throat clearing, about everything. I've been ready all week for bad news to come, but now, right now, I don't believe in bad news. I believe right now that I have overreacted and that this man, with his sore throat and kind eyes, will send us on our way with nothing more than some antibiotics for pneumonia. Fancy telling the grocer that my husband had lung cancer. We didn't know that, and we don't know now, and it could be anything, anything. After all, not everyone who is tested for lung cancer has lung cancer, and we may as well be the lucky ones. And I'm sitting here now and thinking, I always do this, I always overdramatise. The specialist clears his throat again, and then he says it. Lung cancer. There are details about the position of the tumour and something about the cells and other things I don't really hear. I'm supposed to be the one taking it all in, taking notes, not allowing my shock to overtake my mind and cloud out questions. But Russell, the patient, does all that instead, and I am useless. I'm thrown completely. And tears pour down my cheeks. And the specialist says, "Of course you're crying. You're very, very frightened." And that doesn't make me feel better, and I try to stop and I tell Russell I'm sorry. Russell holds my hand and says, "I know, I know. I'm sorry too." And all that thinking the worst, all that time, I just knew that this would be bad. And today, wiping all that away and letting that little bit of hope that it'd be okay after all, letting that take over and wanting the best and wanting it so badly, I thought it couldn't not work out. And this, the worst. We walk out of the office and I don't stop crying for a very long time. I cry all afternoon as Russell inexplicably goes back to work. I lie in bed and weep and howl, and all the while I marvel at my husband, who doesn't cry at all, has an important meeting to go to instead. I don't stop crying until it's time to pick up the girls from school. I wash my face and walk up. And I smile when I see them. I don't say a word. We know he has cancer now, but we don't know enough. We have appointments lined up to find out more, to find out the treatment options. And until we do, it's best we don't tell the girls. So I smile, and I don't say a word. There's a time and a place to tell them, and it's not until we have the facts before us, all of them, until we know just how bad this is and what the world looks like, we won't tell them. And we agree, he and I, not to tell anyone, because the more people who know, the more likely it is that the girls will find out before we're ready. So we don't tell anyone. Except I tell my parents. Of course I tell Mum and Dad. But I swear them to secrecy, and of course, they keep it. It's a lot to hold on to as I go about my business, as I get on the bus, as I say good morning, type at my desk, pour myself a cup of coffee. So we don't tell anyone. Except my parents. And the grocer, of course. I accidentally told the grocer.
You rang me and said, "Do you remember I told you that Russell was just low in spinach and needed iron? Well, that's not true. He's got cancer."
And Lisa, my friend Lisa, whose son goes to school with Bear. But except for my parents, the grocer, and Lisa, I have told no one. When Russell and I lie in bed at night and I try to talk to him, he says, "We don't know what the options are yet. Let's not talk about it." We don't know what it means, and we've got a lot of specialists to see. He wants to keep it in a box, unwrapped, in the back of some cupboard, in a house that isn't ours, in a country that doesn't exist. Russell has good friends and family, aunts, uncles and cousins up and down the coast. But he's been without his parents for most of his life. And something about that keeps him sort of singular as he goes throughout the world. He can keep a secret like this, mull it over in his head, worry through it alone. He doesn't want to talk about it. We go to lung specialists, oncologists, surgeons. A week of appointments and information gathering. The cancer, they say, is in both lungs, at the very top of the lungs, which means surgery is impossible, says the oncologist. But that's wrong, says the surgeon. The oncologists don't know about the new surgical techniques, don't know about what can be done. But it's stage 3B, says the oncologist, which means it's a 1 in 4 survival rate, says the internet, which means it's beatable, says a specialist, which means it's a battle for survival, says the fundraising website, which means it's a gentle palliative chemo option to extend his quality of life for a while, says the oncology registrar. Which, no, it doesn't, says the head of the department, who argues instead for an aggressive chemo-radiotherapy cocktail to save him. There are meetings to be held between the oncology department and the lung specialist and the surgical department. There are decisions to be made and trials to be investigated. We'll have an answer soon, they say. And until we know, they keep saying, it's best not to tell the children. They're firm and at one on this, at least. Everyone knows it's best not to tell the children until there's a concrete plan of action. Kids don't respond well to abstract ideas. Apparently, lung cancer is an abstract idea. They want to know answers. They want to know what happens next. And until we know, it's best to keep quiet. This is what they say about telling the children. Don't tell them until you have all the facts. And they're coming, they say. Don't assume they know what cancer is. You may have to explain it to them. Make sure they know that cancer isn't contagious. Be confident and as honest as possible. Russell nods. I read the pamphlets with an increasing sense of the gulf between the calm parents in the pictures, with their hands gently holding the hands of their children, and me. I watch Poppy and Bear, my darling girls, and I'm sure they know. How could they not? We're so quiet, and we don't laugh, and we don't eat. We hold them tighter and longer than they want. I watch them with him and I wonder if they see it, how painful it is for him to be with them, how much more difficult this whole thing is the moment they come into his line of sight. I watch him help Bear with her homework one night, and I think back to those ridiculous conversations I'd overhear when she was born. When he'd say to friends and family, no, objectively, she's the most beautiful baby you've ever seen. He meant it too. I remember his pleasure watching her walk, talk, read, but also just how very much he's always loved just being around her. There's an outbreak of lice in Poppy's class and he sits with her, carefully going through her hair with lice solution and a fine-tooth comb. She won't let me do this because I'm not gentle enough and I get bored and cross. But he is gentle enough. And when he finishes, he lets her brush his hair, play hairdresser. He doesn't even mind much when he discovers she's used scissors as well. He loves them utterly, without any of the fear and anxiety I have. They are what they are for him. I'm the anxious one, the one who worries that they're all right. He holds them close, but I clutch at them. He's relaxed with his love. I'm fierce with mine. It's with some surprise I realise that, in fact, I'm desperate to tell them. I want them to know because I want them with me. It feels like I've moved on into somewhere new and I can't keep them safe if we're not together, which I know is ridiculous. They should never have to know their father might die. But he might die, and I'm the one they need, and somewhere very deep inside me, I want them close. But I pick them up from school and I'm silent, and I make cupcakes with them, and I'm silent again. And I let them watch television before they do their homework, and I let them eat cupcakes in front of the television, and I cry in the bathroom, and when Poppy asks me what's wrong, I tell her nothing. She gives me a hug, tells me what she did at school that day. After more appointments, he and I have the beginnings of a plan. The head of the department has won out, and Russell will undergo an aggressive, poisonous chemotherapy treatment, followed by radiotherapy. At our meeting with him, the head of the department is optimistic. In August, there's a fundraising bike race for cancer. It's May now, and he tells Russell he'll be able to ride in that race. And Russell smiles broadly. Neither of us mentions that he's never shown the slightest bit of interest in bike racing and is unlikely to start now. But despite it becoming clearer, it's still a secret. We're not sure about when this all starts and how long it will go for. We can't tell the children, he says, until we have all the information. And so no one must know. No one except my parents, the grocer, and Lisa. I've asked Lisa not to tell anyone because telling her was a mistake. Of course she hasn't told anyone. There's neighbourhood gossip we're all happy to partake in, but not this.
You know, when we had dinner parties, you'd be the one hopping up and dancing and Russell would watch. And I think that was just the way he was and that was the way that you are. And that's what made it a good relationship.
What I don't tell Lisa is that I haven't told him that she knows.
Russell opened the front door and I looked at him and just said, "Oh, Sophie home." And he's like, no, she's gone to pick the kids up from school. And I just said, "Oh, she's told me what your results were." And he just looked at me as if to say, you didn't want people to know, he didn't want it to be talked about, and you were just going around telling everybody. Not everybody, but people who mattered. So after I've sort of said, I'm so sorry to sort of hear of your news, and then him looking at me with absolute horror, almost wanting to close the door on me, I ran out the gate and chased you down the road and basically said, Sophie, I think I've got you into trouble.
Later with me, he's furious. This is my secret. This is about me. Which is sort of right, but sort of not. It's about me as well. He says to me, couldn't you just let me keep this to myself? I tell him I'm sorry, and I see how scared he is to tell the kids that he's sick. I see how badly he doesn't want to frighten them. But more than that, he doesn't want to tell them, because telling them makes it real. I tell him again I'm sorry. And this time, he nods, takes my hand, and he forgives me. And then, finally, the plan is well and truly set, and we know what it is and what we're doing. I pick up Poppy and Bear from school on a Friday afternoon. I've brought Katie, our dog, up to the school, which is not allowed. But the girls and the dog really like to see each other as soon as possible at the end of the day. And there's only one or two teachers who care about the no dogs in the playground rule and remind you of it as the dog strains on her leash and yaps with the purest sort of pleasure when she sees Poppy and Bear come out of their classrooms. And the weather's nice and cool, so we walk home the long way through the park and pick up milkshakes, vanilla for Poppy and chocolate for Bear, and nothing for the dog. And their father is waiting for us, which they're not expecting because he's not usually home from work when we get home, but which they like, until he sits them down on the couch and I sit down and we tell them. They don't ask what cancer is, but he explains it anyway. They don't ask if it's contagious, but he assures them that it isn't. And he holds them both and strokes their hair and lets them cry into his chest. And he watches them curl up into a ball and not look at him. And he keeps talking and stroking. And I realise now that they know I can't keep them safe. That it had been so foolish to think that I could, if only they were with me. Poppy is 8 and Bear is 10 when they are told the news. Little creatures who seem to get smaller as he speaks. They're babies again by the time he finishes. Helpless. And all I want now is for them not to know, and I don't want anyone else to know, and I don't want to know either. But we've passed that point. It's time to begin. Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.